Welcome, everyone. We'll get started on our event today. Thank you so much for joining us for another Rise Up Calgary Relaunch Lunch. I see some familiar faces and names on this call today, and really glad to see the contingent of those who have been regularly joining us for the lunches since last year. Also some new names and faces, so welcome to everyone, and thanks for sharing your lunch hour with us. For those who aren't familiar, the purpose of these lunches is to bring together folks from the arts community, as well as entertainment and hospitality industries, to look at new ways of doing things in the time that we find ourselves in. And it's an opportunity to talk about things that have worked thus far, ideas and new opportunities, and hopefully engage everyone to think a little bit about what you might be able to do within your organization or as individual artists or within the properties and venues that you're running, and connect people for new ideas and collaboration moving forward. So to kick things off, my name is Sherry McMaster. I'm a consultant with Bird Creatives and Rise Up Calgary. You'll see on our screen here, we've got four panelists whom I'll introduce shortly. As well, we have Lana here, who is our ASL interpreter, and you can see her on the screen. The speakers will all be pinned on the screen, so we'll remain featured. And just so everyone is aware, we do have a live captioning service for this. It's called Otter AI. If you'd like to use it, you can click on the link on the top left corner, the top left button, and you'll see live on Otter AI. If you click on that, it'll open up another browser where you can follow along with the transcription. And on the call as well is Sam Hindle. Sam is waving. She's our tech help today. So if you happen to have any issues at all with your connectivity, with your video, your audio, all of those things, please feel free to chat with Sam and she will help you out. And to activate that chat function, you can just click on the icon at the bottom of your screen. You can use that to message the entire group or have a private chat with someone. The chat, we usually ask, we welcome people to copy it if they'd like, because people will put connections to links to other resources or email addresses. So if you put something into the chat publicly, it will be captured. And this video is also being recorded today so that we can release it later for those who may not have the opportunity to join us. So before I get to the introduction of our panelists, I'd just like to acknowledge where we're gathered here today. We continue to find ourselves very much in balancing a virtual world and a physical world. And Rise Up Calgary and most of the participants on this call are based in Calgary, Alberta, Mokinstis, as it's traditionally known. It is the heart of Treaty 7 territory, the traditional lands of the Kainai, the Piikani, the Siksika, the Sutina, the Stoney Nakoda Nations, as well as Métis Nation Region 3. And finding Calgary at the confluence of the Bow and the Elbow Rivers, it's been a place that people have traveled to for centuries. They've gathered here, traveling long distance to be in this place for trade, for commerce, to share their traditions and their teachings, their arts and their culture and their stories. And in that spirit of community building, we welcome you here today. We acknowledge all those that have come before us, and we show gratitude for the land that we share and call home. So now it is my pleasure to introduce our great panel. These folks have a vast experience in the hotel industry, in creating art in unusual places. They've all been looking at ways to think outside the box and find new ways of doing things and moving ahead. So first I'd like to introduce Mark Hopkins. Mark is the artistic director of Swallow a Bicycle Theatre, which generates productive discomfort through art making. He is an associate with the Human Venture Leadership, which seeks to build collective capacities to reduce ignorance, error, waste, suffering, and injustice. He volunteers with the Calgary Foundation, the Center for Newcomers, and is a fellow of the Energy Futures Lab. He founded the We Should Know Each Other, which was a community bridging initiative. And while he doesn't have much experience working in hotels specifically, the short film that he co-wrote called One Night in Aberdeen is available to view on Short of the Week. So welcome to Mark, thanks so much for being here. Next up, we have Brad McCarty. Brad is the group sales manager at Hotel Arts. With a passion for arts, events, and hospitality, Brad is a natural at building relationships and executing out-of-the-box opportunities with his clients and partners. As the association group sales manager at Hotel Arts, Brad has been building industry relationships and transforming ideas into inspiring events for the clients. Keeping on top of the latest trends and events, he's an active member of MPI and the local ILEA chapter. With a blend of creative thinking and operational intelligence, Brad was quick to pivot events at Hotel Arts during COVID. He's been a leader to the team in learning and mentoring those team members in virtual and hybrid events. As always, with the events at Hotel Arts, whether they're virtual or executed in person, they always add in twists of elements of arts, culinary splendor, local connections, and excellent customer service. So welcome, Brad. Thanks so much for being here today. And next up on the panel, we have Alisha Reynolds. Alisha is the Vice President of the Sandman Hotels Group. She is based here in Calgary and oversees the company's portfolio of 13 hotels in Alberta, including a team of 300 proud Alberta-based employees and over 1,500 hotel rooms. She previously worked in the restaurant division of the Sandman's parent company called Northland Properties, where she led real estate and development efforts for the brands, including Moxie's, Denny's, Chop Steakhouse, and Shark Club. She holds a Bachelor of Commerce and Juris degrees from the University of Saskatchewan, a certificate in hotel real estate investment and asset management from Cornell, and a Master's of Business Administration from Queen's University. She's also currently the board chair of the Tourism Industry Association of Alberta. So thank you so much for joining us, to Alisha. And last but not least, we have Saul Zia. Saul is the executive director of the Calgary Hotel Association and has been a proud resident in Calgary for over 22 years. His 25-year career has spanned growth and senior leadership positions with Canadian Airlines, now Air Canada, Sears Travel, Transamerica, McCann Worldwide, Loyalty One Air Miles, and WestJet. He also has over a decade of experience in political advocacy, intergovernmental relations, and political board leadership. He's been the past academic chair in areas of loyalty programs, revenue management, and membership programs. And since joining the Hotel Association in 2019, he's enjoyed the opportunity to work collaboratively with the hotel members and the many partners to fulfill their strategic plan of tourism through effective advocacy, collaboration, and investment. So welcome to Saul. And that is the crew that we have assembled today. We're going to have a conversation here about hotel spaces and how to collaborate between artists and hotel spaces. We find ourselves in a position where traditional arts venues are not operational for the most part, but hotels are. And they have underutilized space and are primed for creative partnerships. So I'm going to start off with you. You know, what is it about this kind of collaboration that resonates with the association and you see this as an important opportunity for hotels as a whole?
Well, you know, where I'm going to start is arts, hospitality, and tourism. Arguably, or I would say inarguably, were the first industries to close their curtains in March 2020. We know that arts had to end. It could have been different ways that it came about. But when you look at this amalgamation of industries and how we're working together, these are industries that will also be the last to open at some point in 2021, cross our fingers. So bringing together arts and artists into, you mentioned it, Sherry, our hotel spaces, which are open, but generally vacant, right? We've had historically low occupancies, but we have great spaces. And in the city and in the region, we have great artists. So this all started with just a thought of how do we help arts and artists. And I'm thinking of people here. I'm not thinking about organizations. We could talk about organizations, but I'm thinking of people who need to express themselves and spaces that we have across the city that are open for those artists to express themselves. And that's sort of where it got started in the thought and brings us to where we are today and to this meeting. Are there further avenues to use our spaces and cultivate the arts? Thanks.
Thanks, Saul. You know, speaking of spaces that are available, perhaps haven't been used for arts or underutilized, what could we do with this space? Alisha, I'd like to ask you a little bit about the work that Sandman Hotels has been doing and the gallery and exhibition space that you guys have created. You know, what is it? How did it come about? Why did you guys do this?
Thanks, Sherry. I think Saul's intro was really perfect because as hotel operators, and speaking on behalf of Sandman's 13 locations in Alberta that have been the hardest hit of any of our 56 hotels across Canada. I report into Northland Properties, which is this Canadian-owned company. And so we have 60 hotels internationally, 56 within Canada. and the Alberta portfolio was the hardest hit. And it just felt like a double punch because we were already in this recession and then COVID happened and the numbers became almost unbearable for us. So we didn't have to close any of our locations. I'm fortunate that I work for a very stubborn ownership group, which is really proud and wanted to keep as many people employed as possible. I'm forever grateful for that. But really it was a function of coming into work every day, loving the very few people that I saw, but feeling sort of brokenhearted that we have all of this beautiful space that's not being used. We have heard a lot in other industries about pivoting and coming up with new ways of doing business. And it was heart-wrenching to think, how do I pivot? How do I pivot these assets? Like, we own boxes. We own boxes that are built beautifully and have beds in them and have lamps and all of these wonderful amenities that people just can't use right now. The government is telling us and asking us not to use these amenities in traditional ways right now. And walking into the doors every day thinking, it's just a shame that we have these beautiful properties that aren't being used to their maximum potential. So one of the ideas that spurred this was the reality that we finished about a $15 million renovation and conversion at the property that I'm sitting in right now, which is a Sandman Signature Calgary downtown property, formerly the Sandman Calgary City Center. So we finished that renovation on April 9th, 2020. Tough day to finish that multi-million dollar renovation. And we were standing in the lobby thinking, nothing's been hung on these walls before. Footsteps have not been taken into these banquet rooms before. And we have this space that's bright and really nicely finished right off of the lobby in our main entrance to the property. And so a couple of months back, we finally said, why don't we throw it out there and activate this space in any way that we can by partnering with some awesome folks in the community that would know what to do with this. We are creative thinkers, but not as creative as the brilliant artists on this call and that are out there in our community. So we just started simply with putting a call out on LinkedIn, took some photos of the space and put that out. We ended up getting about 50 responses from various organizations and individual artists that said, yes, it's been so long. It's been a year since anyone has come with this opportunity. And I should mention the spaces that we're offering are free. We're asking for $0, just really loose commitments on behalf of the artists to get out there and just show us what you have, bring in something that activates you and shows our community spirit, but also uses the space. So we're in talks with lots of artists right now regarding various sorts of exhibitions that we could have in there, art of theirs that they would like to hang on the wall. And even if it's as small as bringing family and friends in to show off what they've been working on a private basis, we're happy with that. So really our goal and our idea and motivation is just breathing life into the spaces that we have.
That's fantastic. Thanks, Alisha. Brad, Hotel Arts is a space that's always been known for, you know, things slightly outside the box and artistic endeavors and creative looking at ways of hosting things. You know, what have you guys found as far as, you know, Alisha mentioned pivot, the word of 2020, 2021 will be known for the word pivot. But, you know, you guys have had to switch how you're doing things. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the creative outside the box things that you guys have imagined that have been successful thus far that you're thinking about and what that means to Hotel Arts in a collaboration with artists?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I gotta talk to Saul's comments initially. We are all grouped together in tourism, the arts, the hotels. We are in a long haul here. Like you were saying, it's a matter of the first impacted, but we'll be the last to come back to life in the full respect of what we're used to. And, you know, and you're right, it was a matter of we were hit hard in March. And, but I want to say that we were one of the first hotels downtown to kind of look at reopening again. And I want to say we did that at January 1st at our sister property. And then June 18th was the Hotel Arts reopening. Now, thank goodness we do have such a vibrant, active and creative community because all the ideas were coming out. And I got to give kudos to our big producer, our our creative thinkers out there who did the drive-ins at Telespark, the Hotels Live, you know, the big art displays, which one of which we had in our parking lot for Chinook Blast. Like, it's the creativity of not giving up that really kind of made us look at, okay, well, we need to pivot now. How are we going to do this safely within the guidelines? It was astonishing to me to learn between the months of June to November, we actually hosted close to 300 events of different capacities, from small meetings to smaller receptions, all within the AHS guidelines. And of course, we had a full pool capacity throughout the summer as well. We had a really warm summer and we managed all this. Like, I have to give kudos to the staff. They were working their butts off, and we did it safely. And, you know, so it kind of, it gave us some enthusiasm and hope, not only within the community that we're doing things, but what we could do at the end of the day and how we could start changing things. We were fortunate enough just before we opened in June to actually have a balcony wedding. You know, June is always fun, you know, because we got hail or rain or snow to deal with. And ironically, and, you know, and we did circulate the video for the wedding and it was beautiful. Like, the main wedding, the ceremony was on the deck. All the guests were in the balconies. They were showered in rose petals. It was really phenomenal. And for us to be able to do something like that before we officially opened was just fantastic. Now, what you didn't see in the video is that we actually did get a hailstorm quickly. so we dealt with it, edited that part out. And then we, you know, so those other pieces that we were looking at is we were confident and we were starting to feel tenured, even though it was only a couple months in, that we were doing events safely and we could do this. So how do we start driving business to instill the confidence to our consumer at the end of the day that we're safe, that a lot of people are safe in what they're doing? We spent a lot of time. We're really robust in our health protocol that we made sure that was part of every proposal and everybody knew about. And then from there, we started to look at, okay, how are we going to drive people to come in? Right, we went through the summer. Summer was great, but then we started hitting fall. We started working with our packages for our rooms, the concept of full urban resort, realizing at the end of the day, you know, if someone's stuck in their is stuck in their house all the time, you know, even if they can't use hotel amenities, they're still getting out into a different environment, right? And that alone is a mental break that people need. So we started thinking, okay, what is involved at the urban resort? What have I done on vacation that I love doing? So we started playing with the ideas and we had some very organic relationships that kind of came up, and all of a sudden we're like, yes, let's work together. And so we started playing around with ideas around the pool. When we put that pool cover up, we're only like year two of having that pool cover up for the roof. And so we hadn't had chance to really explore things before COVID happened. So we started diving into, okay, well, when I'm vacation, I go to Drake shows and do, you know, play Drake bingo, Drake trivia. We go to acoustic sessions, we do DJ nights, right? So these are the things that we started playing around with. How do we activate, ticketed events that were supporting the local talent, but also making sure people are feeling safe. This course went into ballroom. What does that look like for a ballroom session where we could get comedians in, again, full drag shows, working with great partners like YYC Jazz, Calgary Civic Symphony, burlesque comedians. There's a lot of opportunity there. And golf suites. You know, you golf on vacation. So we now have golf suites in place, ready to be rented on an hourly basis, where you could do 50 courses over the world or zombie golf, which is, you know, your golf ball becomes a grenade and you get to plow through some zombies, which is fantastic. So, you know, so we're really trying to think outside of the box in that respect. And that goes the same with the artists who approach us at the end of the day. We want to make sure that there's a business acumen around what we could do. We are limited in our staff extremely. So it's great to have someone come to us, say, hey, this is the idea. This is how we could run it. These are the connections I have to help with the process. So it's very collaborative, and it's our time to play. It's our temporary time to play. And maybe some of those ideas won't stick for long-term and regular times, but some will. And I think that's the important piece to remember here is don't be, you know, grab that courage and play with it. Just go out there and play and see what could be done and what could be, because what could be really, truly amazing and be a permanent fixture in what you already provide.
I like that. What could be, Mark, you have experience in what could be in some very interesting different places. I'll let you tell us a little bit about Swallow a Bicycle and you know, doing work in found places that you traditionally wouldn't have a theater show in. I know you've got some slides, a little bit about the work that you do. I'm going to let you share those. But I guess my question is, you know, this being part of your forte of creating art in unusual spaces, what is it about these projects? Any takeaways for artists and arts organizations to think about as they try to go into these kinds of collaborations from your perspective and experience?
For sure. Thanks so much, Sherry. And so rad to be here. I'm really honored to be able to meet all y'all and hear from your experience. For those who don't know Swallow Bicycle Theatre or my work, I've spent the past 15 years or so making theatre, often not in theatres. We've done work in coffee shops, at the top of the Calgary Tower, in warehouses, you know, fields, boiler rooms, you name it. And that's been a really, really rich experience most of the time. I think what has really stood out for me in what makes partnerships across sectors, like when we're moving into spaces that are not usually art spaces or not usually activated in the way that we're activating them, communication is so, so key. It's an act of translation for me as a theater artist and frankly a weirdo indie experimental theater artist to be stepping into a coffee shop or a landmark or a hotel where on the one hand the people that are hosting us are going to have a picture in their mind of what theater is, of what theater requires, that may or may not be what I'm doing. And similarly, I'm going to have a picture in my mind of how a hotel operates, of how a coffee shop operates, that may or may not be reflective of reality. So I think communication, open and regular communication right off the top is really key to be able to speak frankly from both ends about what's feasible, what's imaginable, and then what can be offered. Because I think all three of the previous speakers spoke to the situation we're in right now. And I guess just to briefly swerve into that, to underscore what Sol kicked us off with, artists across the country are, like, even before the pandemic, were among the most economically precarious and vulnerable workers. There was a study out in 2014 that showed that artists' average income was 32% lower than other workers across all other sectors. And that is just amplified for gig artists, freelance artists, and more so for any equity-seeking communities, for artists of color, for Indigenous artists, disabled artists, etc. So we were already challenged pre-pandemic. And then I think a lot of folks on this call will have seen the Statistics Canada, I guess a chart that came out a couple days ago, which I'll share on the screen here, which shows that, you know, this is showing basically GDP comparing February 2020 to December 2020. Across all of the sectors of Canada's economy and looking at the GDP, the shift in GDP over that time. And what we see is this real dip here where over that period, the arts and entertainment sector shrank more than 50%. And vital to this conversation, we see right next to it, accommodations and food, right behind it, dropping nearly 40% in activity. So the two sectors that we're talking about in today's conversation are indeed the hardest hit. And when I see those numbers, I really think about, sure, like my organization has struggled and arts organizations have struggled. But what I'm seeing there is my friends and peers who are not attached to organizations, whose gigs vanished overnight, who are now possibly running into food security challenges and to housing security challenges. And so I'm highly incentivized to accept these fine people's offers to get artists back into space as quickly and as thoroughly as possible. That sort of on a downer note, I can certainly share some examples of what has been done in hotels by artists that I've encountered over the years, and some more tips on how I've navigated spaces. But Sherry, maybe I'll throw it back to you before that.
Yeah, I mean, I guess Brad touched upon this a little bit in his address piece about, you know, what is it that a hotel needs to know from an artist. So it's like, okay, I've got this great idea, you've got this great space, let's do something. And obviously, you know, Mark, as you pointed out, communication-wise, there's a whole bunch of steps in between. But, you know, Brad and Alisha as well, maybe we'll start with you, Alisha. What is it, you know, that you're looking for in collaborative partners? And I'll ask Brad the same question, and then Mark, you know, let's continue the loop around on what does an artist need when they're walking in. Alisha, do you want to start off on that?
Yeah, I think from the hotel perspective, it's really your creativity as the starting point. You have these brilliant ideas about what you do and what you can bring to activate a space. So any injection of creativity would be the starting point. And then really the most foundational piece is a description of the use. What do you need from us to make the space work? Speaking from my perspective in the just over a dozen hotels that we have 100,000 square feet of currently unused banquet space. That is a lot of banquet rooms. Some of these rooms have windows, some of them don't. Most of them are set up like ballrooms. Several of them are smaller meeting spaces. But I really think the sky is the limit with the quantity of space that we have. Every one of our locations has between 1 and 5 meeting rooms. Some of our hotels have 20,000 square feet of space and can host 500 people. Some of them have smaller spaces that are really boardrooms for, you know, 20 people. We have lobbies. We have one hotel, our Sandman Signature Lethbridge Lodge, that is this gorgeous atrium full of tropical plants, and it has 102 rooms with balconies facing in. We've activated that space, just like Brad's point with balcony weddings, which is the sweetest thing to see. Families standing on balconies, taking selfies. New Year's Eve in that space, we hired a band, Marcus Trummer Band came out and played for us. People were so excited. I'll just share a quick story. The night was really fun. We included this food and beverage component and people came. It was mostly people coming from Calgary, Lethbridge, sounding communities who went down there. People were just having so much fun. My husband and I went down and enjoyed that. And the couple next to us was celebrating their 40th wedding anniversary. And they said, it's so nice just to be able to get out and listen to music. It had been so long as of New Year's Eve already last year that people had been living without live music. And it just felt so good to be out there. There was also a lady who put one of our in-room robes on and went out to the balcony and just shouted across to everybody, it's a robe party. And it was so fun because everyone was just laughing and late, and you forget what that's like when you're living through a pandemic and where you're living through a tough time. So we're open to all forms of entertainment. And I would say from the artists, what they could provide would be inspiration to us as to what they're looking for, what use they would like to bring to the property. And then within my portfolio, I would say, let's just match up the ideas to the spaces. I think there's so much potential, and I'm so thrilled that we're having this conversation, and I'm happy for anybody to reach out to me if they do have ideas for how we can activate these spaces.
Fantastic. I'm just going to jump in here really quick, Brad. There's some things that are coming up in the chat about people that are asking, you know, how do they connect with different properties? Sam has can put in the contact information for the folks that are specifically on this call today, that if you have, there you go, she's tossed that in already. So those are the information for the folks that are here today. You know, we'd also encourage people to join our Facebook group you know, for connections there. Saul, being with the Hotel Association, obviously has connections with all the hotels in the city. So I'll just throw that out as people are thinking about, got the creative juices flowing. Now, who do I talk to? Brad, I'll let you jump back in about, you know, from your perspective, what is it that an artist is bringing to the mix that you guys need to know about?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, and I got to share my sentiment with Alisha is at the end of the day, people are really looking to get out and have an experience and have some fun. We were lucky enough to have, when we finally put our entertainment roster together between the pool and the ballroom, and I think we had the opportunity to do our Halloween vampire club. And I was able to attend myself, and oh my goodness, it just was, you could just see people were just so finally getting back to somewhere where they wanted to be. So the drive and the need is definitely going to be out there. So that's a given. You know, what the challenge is that, you know, at the hotel is when we're down to 2% of our overall staff. We are a skeleton crew, you know, and so we are taking every approach for our events and our collaboration with artists a very different way. We are, instead of being told what to do in terms of what their event, a typical customer looks at in terms of what their vision for their event is, we're a lot more in depth now. Like, you know, because you know, in order for us to look at, could we do a concert on the balcony? We had to do a load study right on our roof. Like, and that's one thing that we had to look at from our perspective. We have an amazing marketing team. That's something around promotion we could definitely kind of work towards and help promote things. The tickets that we sell at the end of the day is covering off the full production. And so for a hotel, what we look at is, okay, we are just wanting to F&B, food and beverage, and we just want to service that. So we're, you know, the goal is there to put to people to work to make sure they have that platform, you know, but the pieces that you could really look at approaching us on is, do they have the ability to, do they have any experience in ticketing promotion? You know, do they have experience in the full production management services, entertainment procurement? Maybe they have other ideas in terms of who else could be part of a certain performance. Do they have access to partners who automatically know that we're in COVID time, so we should be exploring COVID prices? You know, your equipment is sitting in the warehouse collecting dust, so let us be your warehouse. And if you need the equipment, awesome, come get it, but just make sure it's back before the next performance. You know, but you know, so it's kind of working together to realize that we're extremely limited on resources, as everyone is. So how do we pull that effort together to make sure that we come out shining on the other end? And you know, and probably one of the biggest pieces is patience. Someone in an artistic partner who has the integrity and ability to pivot just as quickly with you. At the same time, you know, it's been an emotional last year, right? It's, you know, you get that next announcement on AHS and you realize, okay, I got another 3 weeks or a month, you know, and you know, before they might change it again. It's finding a partner who will remain with you side by side through the hard parts. It's important. You do end up feeding off of one another. That positivity is so important. And, but I tell you, after having to move dates, because we haven't actually had a poolside event yet, believe it or not. It's just we had that one ballroom and that was it. We had November hit and we're just like, you know, probably be the poolside will be the first event we could look at leading up to May. And then in May, of course, end of May, we're lifting that roof off and it's a different ball game, right? But you know what? We're ready. We are on a springboard, but we're kind of holding our breath, you know, we're waiting for the okay. And then, but it's ready to go. The marketing's done. The floor plans are done. The entertainment rosters are in place. We got the commitment. We are selling out shows still. And the thing is, our customers have been amazing because they are pivoting themselves. They're saying, hey, keep our money, put it towards the next show. That in itself is amazing. So the crowd is out there. We just need to provide the platform so we all can kind of have a great time again.
Yeah. I know there's other hotels as well that have joined us as guests today. And I, you know, thank you to everybody here for the positivity on what, you know, what could be and the willingness to collaborate and work together and be ready for, you know, what's being offered and what's being allowed as the case might be. Mark, back to you on, you know, the experiences that you have working in these spaces as an artist. I'm always interested in hearing from artists who create things out of novel concepts or off the beaten path things where they said, gee, if I had known that before I started this, you know, anything you want to share on that about the experiences that you've been a part of, that you've witnessed, and how to, you know, words of wisdom for those that might come in on some kind of collaboration like this.
Yeah, you bet. I guess thanks for that opening. I'd like to maybe give a little anecdote and a shout out to Mark Staniloff at Superior Lodging Corporation, who years ago, I, along with my co-writer Charles Netto, wrote a little play, and it was called Super 8. And for those who don't know, Superior Lodging Corporation is the holder, is the manager of the Super 8 hotel properties across Canada. We didn't know that, and we just wrote this little play and didn't think much of it, but then it won some awards. We kept building it. It got picked up by Lunchbox Theatre, and as that unfolded, we were just being artists. We were just like focused on, you know, let's get this script done. Let's get it cast. And at no point did any of us be like, should we ask them if this is okay? Like, should we ask them if it's okay to use their logo to talk about their properties to, you know, it sort of just, it occurred to us, but we didn't really follow it any further until one day when the show was running at Lunchbox Theater, the front of house staff came up to us afterwards. They're like, hey, the Super 8 guy was here. We're like, which Super 8 guy? We're like, the guy. And we had Mark's card waiting for us at the front desk, and we were like, oh my god. We didn't, and we quickly are googling, we're like, oh my god, this is the guy who owns Super 8, and he's here in Calgary, and he came to our show. So we were terrified that he was going to shut us down, and so we like ended up getting a meeting with him, went into his office dressed up in our best suits, and like nervously went into his office. And the first thing he said when we sat down was, guys, that show was amazing. Why didn't you come to me for sponsorship? And we were just blown away, because it could have gone the entirely different direction. But the show is, here, I'll share the show poster. The show is set in Aberdeen, South Dakota on August 8th, 2008, at the world's first Super 8 hotel, on the day that it was rebranding. And it turns out he had been in Aberdeen, South Dakota on August 8, 2008 for the rebranding of Super 8. So he became our biggest fan. He became a huge supporter in helping us actually like get the rights to use all these references and logos. My slideshow is getting out of control here. He supported fundraising, and when we actually turned the play into the film One Night in Aberdeen, he helped us find locations to shoot in. So that was an example of a really terrific partnership that we had with the hotel sector. But also, I think, illustrates the problem, like that us as independent artists are just trying to make our art. We're just trying to finish, like, do all the work of getting the script finished, and don't necessarily have the skill, expertise, networks, background to know what questions we should be asking beyond that. And so I guess a dream for me in this Rise Up process in the arts and accommodations recovery would be for those of us that have resources and expertise, like the organizations, arts organizations, tourism organizations, live events organizations, that especially have access to production staff, to technical crews, and to the artist networks, like especially the independent artist networks of vulnerable gig worker artists who don't have the resources necessarily to come to a hotel and navigate all of the intricacies of new partnership. Like, what would it be like for an organization or a group, a coalition of organizations, to be able to rehire some of the alive event workers that have been, their livelihoods have disappeared, who often have experience working in hotels because of all the conferences, all the concerts, and can also speak artist talk, who can put together the calls for artists, the riders, the technical requests that would just allow artists to come in and do what we're good at, which is do wild and weird events and not have to navigate all of the bureaucracy that's accommodating it. Because we have wonderful resources in the city, like Calgary Arts Development, and specifically Joni Carroll, the Arts Spaces consultant, who for years has been acting as the translator, who has been being the bridge between different sectors. But again, just dozens, hundreds of live event workers who work for the city, who are at IATSE, who are no longer able to work at Theatre Calgary, at ATP, at Vertigo, at Esker Foundation, at the Glenbow. That's my dream. So I know there's people in this chat who run organizations like that. A whole bunch of Heritage money is coming loose. A whole bunch of Canada Council money is coming loose. There's Rise Up. So I wonder if this conversation can inspire anyone to pick up that baton and start to hire artists.
Thanks for that, Mark. I mean, that's exactly the idea, is, you know, what can everybody come to the table with? How can we collaborate together and use this? So thanks for introducing those. Alisha, I know when we had spoken previously, one of the things that had come up that, is like Mark, like, wouldn't it be great if we're in a position right now where we can't necessarily get a whole group of people together to do something in regards to like a tour, or, you know, in the tourism industry, I think they call them familiarization tours. You would refer to them as, you know, an artist assessment. Rise Up had talked about doing this, and I think it's something in the future that I just want to lob out to you, to everybody, you know, Saul, looking at the different hotel partners and different groups that are in the association, utilizing spaces to say, bring in a group of artists and say, what could we do in this space? You know, wouldn't it be amazing if we had this happen coming? You know, I've always said I would love to see some of these huge atriums have aerial dancers come down the walls. Like, wouldn't that be amazing? Sky's the limit. You know, so how do you think like familiarization tours or some of these artist assessments, a way that we could potentially get something like this going? What's the benefits of that, and how could we do this?
Thanks, Sherry. Yeah, and I'll try not to speak too fast because I'm so excited from this interaction. But absolutely, broaden your horizons, think big. You know, so to bridge on Alicia's point, across the city, we have millions of square feet of space that are sitting in some ways idle. And there are so many categories. So, you know, Brad talked about the weddings and Alicia talked about the art, but it can be any form of art. You know, right now in the city, there are seven film productions using hotel space. So film and TV, whatever, it's not just visual arts, it's not just performing arts, it's any type of art that can be brought together. The one thing I want to lay into here, though, you know, sort of as a foundation, is the hotel industry has historically been one of the safest industries ever created, you know, certainly in Canada. And I'm still sitting at the table. We eat AHS guidelines for breakfast. And, you know, if you have the great idea, we are the experts, and the spaces across our city are absolute experts in delivering the safe experience, whether it's for individuals or for artists just in and of themselves. So, you know, not to go on and on and on, I certainly could. Bring your ideas forth. Contact me if you have an idea, whether it's geographic or you're looking for a space. There is certainly space, and there's certainly aptitude for the hotels to deliver. And I want to bridge on one of Brad's comments. There's many things that after COVID goes away, we don't want to come back. But this amalgam between arts and hotels, I hope never goes away. This is a moment in time that I think should transcend the pandemic and be, you know, a continuous stream of activity and work, because there's no harm, there's only good in us working together. Between hotels and between artists that need it. And, you know, Mark brought that up. We had a historical, there was a historical lag for artists already. And we're in a darker time and these spaces are available. It's just a matter of bringing the ideas through. Just to quickly close off, you know, Circus, I had the honor to briefly be at Cirque de la Nuit, which was at the Delta South as part of Hotels Live. And yes, there was a lot of excitement on the balconies, but I could see it on the artists' faces, just being able to express themselves. That's all they wanted to do. There could have been cardboard cutouts in the balconies, I'm certain, and they just were happy to express themselves. So, I'll close off, bring your ideas forth. Contact me. I do my best to contact everyone who gets through to me. We can bring your art or how you want to express yourself to a hotel, because hotels are open. And that's it.
Saul. I wanted to just jump in.
As Leslie Plumley knows, I'll shut up now.
She tells you that. I just want to build on that, because we've been talking about a lot of really big ideas, and those are certainly the ones that get people excited and they're making the headlines in the news because they're big events. I've also fantasized about a great artist reaching out and saying, you know what, I want to play my guitar in your lobby because it's just been so long since I've played my guitar in front of others. If that's you, if that's someone you know, bring that idea too, because I think there's a lot of magic in that, just the connectivity for some young artists, especially to get emerging artists to be able to get to perform and share what they love to do with others. It doesn't need to be a big revenue generation idea oriented and, you know, how we both make a return off of it, though there is that part that, you know, we want to contribute to the economy and to artist success as well. But small ideas that are rooted in the spirit of community, I think, are just as important. Some other ideas that have come across or through our minds would be, what about an artist doing something virtually? Say we had a staycation weekend at any property in Calgary or the region, and there was an artist who taught kids how to paint something or how to write poetry or something else. There are virtual ways of connecting that we can turn into a sense of place by nature of gathering together safely in a hotel. So there are many ideas that I think don't need to all be about being in one room and waiting for that to open. I think there's a lot of opportunity to look at the green space and ways that we can connect safely between now and then as well.
Thanks, Alisha. Yeah, I think another, you know, we've got people on this call as well that are production workers, designers, that sort of thing. I think an interesting idea too, a lot of hotels are coming up with ideas for themes, themed staycations. And so a question about, working with designers to do themes and decor and that kind of thing. I think that's another whole opportunity for folks to think outside the box on ways that, you know, we could theme things up for some staycations or events or decor. You know, that's another piece to think about with some of the folks that are on this call. Another way to think outside the box there. I want to just say on the comments here that are going on, if anyone has any questions, feel free to put them in the comments, in the chat, and we'll get to them. And I encourage everybody to, you know, to scroll through here. Steve's put a couple of things out here about some other resources to link for Side Door and Stagehand, which is connecting to artists. As well, Joanne here from One Yellow Rabbit has said, I do want to remind that artists also need to make money and pay rent and buy food in addition to expressing themselves. I feel like it's important to keep that in mind. And so I think that's, you know, that's an important thing for sure, that the idea is to get people, you know, back to work and talk about, you know, Brad talked a little bit about ticket sales and that sort of thing, that there is a mutually beneficial piece here. By no means is there an idea of, you know, artists giving their art away. But, you know, how can we collaborate in this way? So thank you to Joanne for that. And like I said, if you'd like to put anything in the chat as far as a question, or if you want to come on screen and ask your question, you can use the raise your hand function and we'll throw to you as well. So I encourage everybody to share their thoughts and their questions. Brad, did you want to jump in at all about, riffing off of what Saul and Alisha have just been chatting on?
Yeah, no, absolutely. You know, and very true. You know, we're all at a point where, you know, we are in survival mode. Let's just be honest. we all are. And, you know, so one thing I've realized, especially in the entertainment world, is how close you all are all together. And everybody's worked with someone in this one event, or maybe this one last year. And, you know, through those connections and through those conversations, I'm starting to become very aware of, like, wow, we just need to start talking to people. And, you know, and did I know that, you know, that sponsorship was available in an industry that wasn't really impacted by the pandemic. So there's an opportunity to lower your production costs, and maybe, you know, that could benefit the overall production. So the tickets are cheaper, so people get paid more. You know, it's just, there's an avenue there where, you know, the expertise is so vast. Oh my goodness. So, but it's just really connecting at the end of the day and just seeing what we could do together. To kind of keep pushing through this COVID world we're living in right now. And it's just, if you have a friend and they need help, go for a walk. You know, it's just, we all have those people who, everybody's at a different level, right? You know, and I can't toot more that it's a matter of, if we need to do, you know, virtual events are a real thing. You know, I think virtual events on its own will eventually cast into hybrid events where you have a combination of in-person and hybrid, and then eventually full in-person, but everybody is at their own comfort level. So why not include as much everybody as we can at the end of the day, and to give that break of what they're going through, whether they're at home on their computer or whether they're in person enjoying, or, you know, or in that respect. So, yeah. So it's just those pieces where, you know, you need a friend to lean on, you know, let's talk about it. You have a coworker you've worked with one time, they're part of a production. Maybe you could be part of that, and, you know, a small part of that. It's just, it's really kind of in, you know, an area like Rise Up was created because of COVID, and it is a support group. We also have support groups within our associations as well. And, so, you know, never undervalue of the connections, the friendships you've made, because this is where it's going to count. And so we all could come out on the other side.
Thanks, Brad. Thanks for that. A question that's come up in the chat here from Perpy. It says, will the artist be responsible for audience, or will there be audience on the ground? Would you guys like to comment on that? Alisha, your thoughts on, you know, or Saul too? Anyone. I'll Mark as well, how do you see that working? I'll throw it out to all of you. Any comments that you have about that question from Perpy?
I'll start, okay. We rehearsed our talking over each other. It can go both ways, right? So we know that artists have a community. So artists will often bring a community, and we've seen events through the city, which were, let's call it closed loop, where the artists brought their community in and they consumed the art, whether it was performing art. But certainly, you know, there are Hotels Live is on this call. There are, and Show Pass locally, there are avenues to generate the audience and the ticket sales, to Brad's earlier point. So it can be done both ways. You know, part of it is we've got to start with the conversation. You know, what do you need? And then it's that matchmaking to bring together local partners, not just hotels, but through sales and promoters, to bring that audience to the artist if the artist feels they need our help in bringing that audience to them.
Yeah, I would build on that, and would also like to address Joanne's comment within the chat about artists certainly wanting to derive some revenue out of this exercise. It's not just about the expression. Stay your hands up. We've been operating not-for-profit hotels for the past year, and it hasn't been very fun. That's not the industry, and not how we can provide jobs for our people either. So we're definitely with you. The inspiration behind this programming is, how do we get people back to work? How do we get our guests to come back in the door and enjoy their experiences? So I really think it's about starting with a seed, which is a creative idea. What do you have to share? What do we have to share? And how do we bring that together? And then how do we make sure that it's a mutually beneficial arrangement? Certainly, both parties need to stand to benefit some from the effort that it would take to pull these things together. But say if it was something like that idea of virtual art classes, where somebody is presenting art or sharing a lesson of some variety to people staying in the hotel, maybe it's a royalty that's generated for every room sale that's generated. The artist receives a certain portion and the hotel receives a certain portion. portion. So really, I think it's about starting with the seed of the idea and then deciding what is the scalability, what is the market for this, and then how do we take it from there? I think the big benefit that the hotels can also bring is that we have a vested interest in this idea generating jobs, opportunities, dollars for our properties as well. So we would certainly have marketing efforts behind any art-related communication and event that we have. So that's all going to be there. We just start with the idea and then build it out from there so that it works for both sides.
And just to add on to that, you know, there's certainly the challenges with running an event that's ticketed, because you only have a certain amount of tickets, certain amount of tables available, or in my case, a certain amount of balcony rooms available, or, you know, depending on AHS, right, we have a certain amount of tables around the pool side. So within that, that's kind of capping our abilities and actually setting us a budget immediately. It's like, this is the ability we can meet. And so it gives you the budget, but then there's the other piece of, you know, getting the audience, right? And the audience, I think, is, you know, I think anybody at the end of the day who's coming forth with an idea, it becomes everybody's responsibility to kind of manage that that audience, that potential audience. We certainly have a email list, you know, that we could make sure that we're doing the marketing around, but those other venues, like Rise Up, Tourism Calgary, you know, we're all hitting local. We are, you know, so it's local people you're bringing in. So that's a piece where we kind of go, hey, well, who am I connected to at the end of the day? And who can I get them to kind of help advertise this piece? So this could be a big success, you know, get some money in people's pockets at the end of the day and just help, right?
Thanks, Brad. Mark, did you want to jump in on this one from an artist perspective, as far as, you know, audiences, revenue share, all of these kinds of things?
I think they've covered it pretty well. I mean, the challenges with audience were real before COVID, and now on top of all of our complications, on top of the existing challenges of gathering audience, there's the complication of gathering audiences safely. So I really admire the ingenuity of using balconies, of rooftops, giant conference rooms. That is really wonderful. And there might be an opportunity, like I know a perceived barrier, I don't know if it's a true one, but in the before time for me as an artist of working with hotels is sort of the expected bottom line that, you know, you often the perception is that hotels are working in the big leagues, that you've got big conference rooms that can host enormous numbers of people, which are pretty daunting for an indie artist, for someone who, you know, gather, like a good day is 50 people show up, you know, that's a great day. So I wonder if the circumstances we're in is an opportunity to start doing, as Alisha, you were pointing towards, some of these smaller scale interventions that can actually potentially cross-pollinate between an artist's existing hungry audience that maybe hasn't seen them all year, and some of the networks that hotels have access to that we wouldn't, in sort of these higher risk from a virus standpoint, but perhaps lower risk from a revenue and crowd standpoint. It's a potential opportunity right now.
Thanks, Mark. I've got Steve with his hand raised here to ask a question. Steve, you want to unmute yourself and chat with us?
There, can you hear me?
Yes.
Awesome. I don't know what it's worth. I'll try not to take up most of your time, but I've got several profiles on every different platform from, what the heck is it? All the different ones where you showcase your band, like Side Door. So I got a gig coming up this Saturday through Side Door. I was searching last month for a venue to host it. I had hosted the show at a coffee shop in Okotoks in December that went well with Jay Burns and Joey Pringle. And collectively, we did like a live venue, sold live tickets, and went online through a live, like through Side Door, which is a live online. But we did both. We did a combination where I brought my computer, set it up for like Side Doors, like a Zoom call like this, where you play, all the pictures are all in front of you and you just play on stage to the computer, which is relatively close. But then you're playing to a live audience too. So you're kind of pandering to both, which is kind of a weird thing to ignore the audience, to look at your computer screen. And so you kind of need a moderator, but we're doing it again this Saturday through Side Door because I couldn't find a venue large enough to host my full band. So I'm doing it through my sound guy's basement this Saturday. But I think with all the bars, like I remember in the late 90s, in the 90s, there's like five or six different live full music venues, which from the crossroads off 16th Avenue, the hotel there, and to the Ranchman's, which just closed last year, which I was the last full band booked there to get canceled. And then our band was the last band to play there last March before COVID. On March 12th, we played for the Battle of Bands, looking to get live music back into the bars again. And then COVID struck right after the oil, gas, everything. It's just, I'm sure everybody's in the same boat. But as an artist, I just need I think that collectively, if there's a way to do a live and an online collectively, that could work too. So if Saul was saying something about, or Brad was saying something about how the space would work for getting the optimum use for the people that are gonna be paying the money to watch, and everybody benefits from that, I think maybe there's a collection of a live online gig with a live in person. And I've reached out to several different hotels over the last year, sending them EPKs. Nobody's returned. I must be sending them to the wrong people because no one's returned any kind of information like, hey, we got your EPK, which is just my promo kit to be like, hey, if you guys are interested in working with me and my band, we're looking for a space, and kind of like a ticket sale type thing where I could advertise through my social media and what have you. But yeah, I don't know if that makes any difference or if that helps anybody, but that's just the perspective from me as a band and us trying to find places to play. So, leave it at that.
A question that I have, maybe Saul, representing the association, if it's possible. I know every hotel is struggling, if it's possible. I know every hotel that, you know, if you want to talk to somebody about, because we're obviously not talking about traditional, I'm going to have a wedding and I need to talk to the event manager who books the weddings. Is there somebody in a hotel structure, whose role is that? Knowing that every hotel is different, but is there a rule perhaps?
There are people, thanks Cher, there are people on this call who, and I see Rob Sierenowski's face is lit up and Jane Mitten is there. There are people, Steve, to your question, that are doing this right now. It can start with me in a conversation, but Rob Sierenowski in Hotels Live and Jane Mitten through Plain Jane Events, they're already working on the solutions between artists like yourselves to the hotel, whether it's performance or, you know, I don't know about hybrid. I'll let the experts speak for that. But there's already experts that are available and on this right now who successfully run these events. And, you know, not it necessarily answers your question, but I see Rob there. I see Jane. Steve, I'd probably just open up an email or a phone call between you and Rob, and you could start talking about what's possible. It's as simple or as complicated as that.
Thanks, Saul. Kaylee is on this call. Kaylee Bicycle from Bird Creatives and Rise Up. I think she's raised her hand to jump in on this. Kaylee, are you there?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Awesome. So I just wanted to say really quick, because I think, you know, we've been really focused on how we are serving, you know, these untraditional venues and artists and making those connections. And as Saul just said, we've got Jane on the call, we've got Rob, Leslie was on it. And as Mark so eloquently put, we've got this whole group of gig workers, so promoters, presenters, stage managers, you know, lighting folks that are all out of work too. And I think something that we can do at Rise Up, and we do have, we put the link to the Facebook page, is it would be really, in addition, while we're making these connections, we could help or bridge that gap between those industry workers to maybe connect with artists who are looking to do something, with these different hotel partners that are looking for, you know, since we're all working with lean teams and we don't necessarily have everything in-house anymore, maybe that's the glue. And so, you know, they can come up with those ideas of like, what is the bottom line? How do we, promote this? How does this all come together in a safe way and manage that process so that it's taking a little pressure off the hotels and the artists to, you know, have to start from square one, because these professionals are used to doing that. And so please join our Facebook page, our industry collaboration group, where you can connect very organically. But also if you're, you know, we've got hotels reaching out to us for ideas. We've got artists reaching out to us for ideas. So if you're one of those industry folks who's looking for creative ways to create work, please be in touch with us too. And we're happy to connect you with these hotels who are looking for support and these artists as well. So I really just thought that was such a great point today. So please follow up with my team and join the Facebook page.
I think that's a really good point, Kaylee. I'll just say briefly, segueing from Kaylee's point and Steve's. Steve, I think one of the reasons that you might not hear back from hotels if you are reaching out to them is to Brad's earlier comment that we're running really lean. I know it sounds crazy, but we have hotels where there's sometimes only one employee in the hotel at any given time. That sounds so bonkers given previous occupancy levels, but we do have properties that are running with one person at a time because we just have so few guests. And it could be a function of just the level of intimidation, not knowing what to do with that idea or how it turns into something beneficial for you as the artist. So I think the glue being Rise Up is a wonderful starting place. And I can say from a hotel operator's perspective, having an idea that comes through that's a little bit baked in terms of like, what is this and how does it become something, would really stretch the runway to a point that it probably comes to fruition rather than starting as an email that we all have to figure out. So I think that's a really helpful comment.
Thank you. Thanks for that. I see that Rob's put his hand up here. Rob, you want to jump on and ask your question or make your comment as the case might be?
Yeah, sure. Hey, everyone. I did want to jump in to Steve's point too. You know, this is what I do, you know, as a talent buyer, as an agent, now promoter. We handle the bands and we are able to, you know, we've come up with this model here with the hotels, right? So we're working both ends and we understand all sides of that. So we feel, you know, three or four at least a day artists that come to us wanting to come and play it on our stages that we have right now. So I would just, direct your information over to us. We're not always able to respond immediately, but we will get back to you and we can help facilitate, you know, those answers, you know, to help direct you accordingly. And we're working with a lot of local artists. We're working with, bigger artists and we're looking to expand, you know, not only to other venues here in town, but to other markets as well. So we're really getting momentum here. And I see this group and Rise Up coming together now in a way that I think we're ready to, you know, we're ready to jump off. So, the hotels run hotels generally. So don't be dismayed if you're not getting the answers that you are looking for right away. But, you know, someone as myself in the business, connect with me and I can certainly help direct you or we can collaborate together.
Thanks very much, Rob. That's great. We only have a few minutes left here, and I do want to be mindful of everyone's time, but something did just come up that Tiffany has asked about here, saying in the chat, what are the current restrictions that we need to keep in mind when hosting live events with artists and bands? So obviously this is something, you know, and Rise Up's purpose is very much to say, how do we get people back to work and experiencing live events and arts safely. So Tiffany, that's probably a fairly large question. Knowing Saul, that you've been in on a lot of the conversations and advocacy to the government and AHS about this, can you give a bit of a quick overview on that? And I see that Sam has put in the link to the Alberta government, the enhanced public health measures, which are current and up to date. Saul, do you have any comments about that you want to throw out?
Sure.
at the end.
And I can be brief. It really comes down to the parameter of audience or non-audience. So, you know, Alisha brought up an idea when we were rehearsing for this around a poetry slam. So spoken word, visual art, you know, can have, so the nuance is audience versus non-audience. Of course, a performance would have audience, although Hotels Live is an example. Balconies are not an audience. It's different than a theater. So that is the simplest way to try to engineer it, is what are the audience parameters that are required, and that sets the scope for which AHS guidelines would apply in terms of permission.
Great. Thanks very much, Saul. And yeah, Tiffany and everyone else on that call, Sam's put that link. So those guidelines are up to date as per the government website. And so I would encourage everybody to take a look at that. Venues as well are very used to working with AHS. And so they do have contacts as well. So if you're doing something within a hotel, I would say that, you know, there's resources in that hotel. They're obviously operating to AHS permit, you know, restrictions right now, and so they would also be able to help you navigate that in partnership with using their venue. One other thing I want to just introduce here at the end, as it were, is the idea of staycation packages and hotel packages. So this is something that hotels have traditionally done for a very long time. How do you package together experiences, shopping, food, opportunities, tickets, that kind of thing. Through has always happened, but we've been looking, Rise Up's been looking at different ways to have some of those packages happen that involve an arts component as well as a hotel component. So over the last several months, we've done a few, helped bring people together for things like the Dave Kelly Live Show and Hotel Arts for the lighting of the Calgary Tower, through Theatre Calgary streaming Christmas Carol to your room in the Fairmont Palliser to have a Christmas staycation with your family there. So there's all kinds of different opportunities there that I think what we'd like to encourage as Rise Up is for people to think about that. If you've got an arts event or an arts installation or something that you think could package well with a hotel stay. One of the members of the Bird Creatives team, Michelle, is sort of heading that up and helping to make connections between hotels that would be interested in packaging and artists and arts organizations that have events or pop-ups, that there could be a nice fit to there. So Sam, if I could just, Sam's tossed it in there. Michelle at birdcreatives.com. If you are a hotel that's interested in packaging, if you're an artist that's got something cooking that you think would be a good hotel package, I'd encourage you to reach out to Michelle, and we'd be happy to connect people there to see, you know, what opportunities exist for some fun staycations. I know all of the folks on this call do different kinds of staycations, and so we're interested in opening those up to more artistic opportunities and staycations. I think we've come really close to the end of our time. And so thank you so much to everybody here. This has been a really great conversation. I feel like we could possibly sit here all afternoon and continue this on. Does anyone just have anything quickly here that they want to, I don't want to leave anybody that's got something, any of our panelists that has something on the tip of their tongue that they want to say before I give a wrap up.
Don't lose hope. We got this. We're all in it. We're feeling it. And our hearts are with you. Our love is being sent to you as well. We're in it together. And I can't wait till we're through it. But while we're in it, we're still lots of love to all of you. Thank you.
Absolutely. And, you know, keep the momentum, keep the hope, you know, and it's okay to be sad and hopeful at the same time. It's a roller coaster out there. Just appreciate the times that you are hopeful, and but appreciate the point that you actually are allowed to be sad, because it is one of those pieces, right? But keep that momentum going, and we'll make this go, we'll get through this all. Yeah.
Thanks.
And I'll toss in, if anyone's looking for inspirations, I tossed some extremely cool examples of hotel performances into the chat, so scope those out. And I'd also say, whether it's in a hotel or not, whatever opportunity you have to uphold by the work of and amplify Black, Indigenous, and POC artists, or frankly, BIPOC folks in all parts of the city, those communities are historically marginalized by our colonial systems and are being hit the hardest by this pandemic. So if you can buy art by a Black artist, please do so.
Thank you, Mark. I want to thank everybody here for sharing their time and their stories and joining us here on their lunch hour. I hope that everyone has enjoyed this session and has been inspired by fantastic things that are happening and ideas of stuff to come. And I'd like to thank all of our panelists for being here. Lana, thank you so much for interpreting for us today. And thank you to Calgary Arts Development for their sponsorship of these lunches. Our next Relaunch lunch is going to be happening on Thursday, April the 8th. And this one is going to be looking at different grassroots advocacy groups that have been popping up and what are some of the common obstacles and concerns being raised about Relaunch and how we can look at a common set of recommendations moving ahead. So we're finalizing our panelists as we speak. Information and the registration for that will just be coming out shortly. So I would encourage you to watch the newsletters of our civic partners for more information on that. Also to join our Facebook group. It will be announced there. It's a brand new group of people. The address went into the chat, the link's in the chat there. So please join there. Also, we're asking there if you have a comment about a topic that you would like to hear discussed in these lunches, leave us a note on the Facebook page. We're always looking for ideas on ways, you know, what do you guys want to talk about? What do you want to hear? And with that, I say thank you so much. Have a lovely afternoon. Be well, stay creative. We will see you in April. Thanks to everybody for being here.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.